Well, hello and welcome to Pleasant Grove Community Church. We are so glad you have chosen to join us for worship today. We've got a great worship service planned for you. We hope that you will be drawn into the presence and awe of God today. I have just one announcement I want to share with you. We've got a great event for women coming this Saturday. It's a little mini retreat, about 45 minutes long, but it's meant to be an inspiration to you to kind of start your new year off right. It will be online, it'll be on video, so that you'll be able to go and watch it anytime you would like. We will send out an email link on Saturday for it. It'll also be on our website. You can look for it there. But it will be fun. There'll be music, there'll be nostalgia, there'll be inspirational message. Look forward to being part of that if you're one of the ladies here at Pleasant Grove Community Church. And now, let us prepare ourselves for worship.
Well, this morning for worship, before I read our call to worship, I just want to introduce to you two new members for the worship team that will be joining us from time to time. This is Asia, and this is Kay. They are students from Jessup, and I'm so excited to have them here to worship with us. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 33, verse 8. It says, "Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him." Now, I just want you to think a moment about the word awe and what it means to be in awe of the Lord for you in particular. It could be thinking of his power, his majesty, his grace, being out in nature, having times of prayer where you're in awe of the Lord. Or perhaps the way that he sent his son to die just leaves you in awe. So as you think about those things, come into worship in a state of awe. Now let's worship together. What can wash?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
For my pardon.
For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
This is all.
This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Faith proved of more worth than
rejoice. I will declare God is my victory and He is here.
This is my prayer.
This is my prayer in the battle when triumph is still on its way.
This is my prayer.
This is my prayer in the harvest when favor and providence flow. I know I'm filled to be emptied again. The seed I've received I will sow. I will bring praise. I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall. I will declare God is my victory and He is here.
Amen.
It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Darkness, you give hope, you restore.
Well, I have the pleasure of leading us in our prayer time together today. So before we get there, though, I wanted to just remind you that our missionary this month is the Liberti family with Proclaim International. Now, if you read the source that came out, I believe it was the first, it was actually on New Year's Day. They are in the process of getting ready to move back here to the United States. They've been over in Germany serving with Proclaim. Doing a wonderful work over there, but they are coming back and going to take on roles with Proclaim International at the headquarters in Florida. And this will allow both Steve and Don to be closer to their aging parents, which is always really important, as well as be a little bit closer to their girls that are both attending Taylor University in Indiana. So they've got a big move ahead of them, and that's something we need to be praying about. So as we go to prayer, let's be thinking about the Liberti family and just quiet our hearts before the Lord, and then I'll lead us in prayer together. Heavenly Father, we are just so grateful to be in your presence this morning. We love you so much, and we are just awestruck at how wonderful you are, your majesty, just your glorious being. Your love for us and your care for us, Father, is just more than we could ever imagine. Father, we do pray right now for the Liberti family, for Steve and Don and the girls as well, especially now as they prepare to make this international move, especially during a pandemic. Lord, I pray that you will just give them wisdom as they make their decisions about the move, that you'll be with them as they pack and prepare to move their household, that you be with them as they say goodbye to the folks in Germany that they've been working with so closely. Father, I just pray that you'll just make that move go so smoothly, even with all the challenges that might be happening around them. And Lord, I just ask that as Steve and Don go to the headquarters office with Proclaim, that you will be with them in their new roles and just encourage them and keep them and just cause them to feel your arms wrapped securely around them, Father. We thank you for them. We thank you for their ministry. We thank you for their ongoing ministry with Proclaim. And Lord, we also praise you that as a church family, we've been able to help support them. Thank you for that, Father. Father, we do pray for those in our church family who are ill and or hospitalized or who have recently lost loved ones. Lord, we just ask your special touch on each and every one. Heal bodies, Lord. Heal hearts. We thank you for that. And as Pastor Phil mentioned last week, we've had a lot of people call for healing touches for their extended family members and friends. And Father, we continue to pray for those that our people know and love, that you would just be with them and heal their diseases, Lord. Heal their hearts. Draw people to you. Father, as our state and country and the world faces this resurgence of COVID, and not just a resurgence of the old COVID, but also these new strains that are starting to come up, I just pray your grace on us, Lord. You have kept us, and we thank you for that. But we pray for all of those around us who are doing the best they can to avoid illness, Lord. We just ask that you would cause this disease to stand down. We thank you for the vaccines that are becoming available, and we just trust you, Father, that this pandemic will stand down. Father, my heart was broken when I saw what happened at our country's capital the other day. Our country needs you, Lord. We are a broken people. And I just pray that you will work in the hearts of those who were in the middle of that protesting, that were doing damage to our capital, that you would just cause them to realize that that's not the way to make yourself heard, to make your concerns known. And Father, I just pray that you would draw us back together as a united people here in the United States of America, and cause each one of us to be proud of our heritage, Lord. We need you, Lord. Draw people to you, Father. We thank you for that. Again, we thank you for your wonderful goodness, your kindness, your love, your just awesome care for each one of us. And as we close our time in prayer, Father, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Well, we wanted to thank you again, dear church family, for your generous giving, for the ongoing ministry here at the church. Even though the church building is closed, we're all still here just continuing to minister in ways that you've asked us to do and the way that God has asked us to do. We continue to look for your offerings and your giving on into this new year. And you have two methods to give. One is by mailing checks to the office at 1730 Pleasant Grove Boulevard here in Roseville, 95747. The other option you have is to go online through our website at www.pgcc.church and sign up for online giving. Either way is perfect. And we do thank you so much for all that you do for each one of us. We love you dearly. God bless.
Well, I'd like you to watch something this morning. And when I say watch, I mean really watch. Look closely. Pay attention. Pay attention to what you see. And watch for things that maybe catch you a little bit off guard, or are beautiful or wonderful or so unique or different that they take your breath away a little bit. But I want you to watch a short video and just pay attention. Thank you. Well, in watching that, like, what caught your attention? Wasn't it amazing? Some of the birds, some of the scenes of the animals, the rhinoceros, just different created beings that God's made. And even the earth itself, just it really catches you. And it is kind of an awesome thing to watch that. I'm going to read scripture for us this morning that comes from Psalm 8. And Psalm 8 is really about God's creative abilities as well. And so as I read this, pay attention. Listen closely. Let your mind's eye grab on to the thoughts and the phrases that are used by the psalmist. Listen then to Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who have set your glory above the heavens. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Wow. What caught you? What stood out to you as I read Psalm 8? Amazing. The wonder of God. You know, as I thought about how to kind of launch into this new year, what themes would be the best themes for us to tackle? What would be a great starting point for us? And as I thought that through, I thought, wow, it would be great for us to begin by looking at awe, the awe of God. What does it mean to be in the awe of God and in awe of Him? And let me make a suggestion. You know, like take a lead in your own life with this. You know, just choose a pathway, a fresh hope, a positive way, kind of a new commitment as we begin a new year, because a new year gives us kind of a chance to do that, doesn't it? It allows us to kind of start with a clean slate and a fresh way of looking at things. And even in our spiritual life, we want that. And so let me suggest that you like kind of drive a stake kind of into the ground a bit. Take a firm stand and say, this year I want to be captivated by the awe of God. And I want God to be at the center of my life. That's really what we'd like to see. To rediscover awe. And that's what our series will be about. It's really, how do we rediscover that sense of awe of God in our life? Exciting, isn't it? I hope you'll stay with us on this. What raises your awe level? I ask myself, what are the things that bring awe, like to me, to the forefront? And there are many, but I just pulled a couple of pictures up, and there's two of those. The first one is this one. It's of the redwoods. I love the redwoods. I grew up kind of in the redwoods, and we would go and visit some parks that had gigantic, majestic trees that just kind of spoke of the power of God and the just the majesty of God. The second one, this one, it's of the coast. It's of the ocean, and it's really the Northern California coastline, which is just those crashing dynamic waves as they just explode next to the shoreline. And as a college student, I would oftentimes in the evening, I would drive over to the coast and I would sit up on a bluff, and if the moon was out, it was fantastic because you could watch as the waves broke on the shoreline, just this explosion of white, like fireworks going off and the loud kind of thunderous roar. Man, all right, even now it just grips me. I love that, the power and majesty of God. And I don't know what that's like for you, things that bring awe to you. Maybe it's the Grand Canyon, or maybe it's Rocky Mountain National Park or some other place, or maybe it's even just the wonder of a human being, how God has so intricately and uniquely placed and put together all of the just smallest parts of a human to make everything work together. Just the overwhelming sense of God's ability to create. Perhaps it's just seeing the creative process of men and women and the things that they have created over time, and to just marvel at the abilities of some people to create. Wow. But just think of it. Amazing, isn't it, what God has done? What God has done. There is a place for awe in our life. God created us to have that place. But in the center of that place, God should be. It should be the God of wonder and awe for us. That is the place. God at the center. God at the center. You know, I read this. I've been reading a book lately. It's just a book entitled Awe. And it's by Paul David Tripp. And in the book, he kind of gives a sort of a helicopter view of what awe is like for people. And just before I kind of walk through some of those that he lists, listen to this quote that he says. Our hearts are always captured by something. That's how God made us. But sin threatens to distract us from the glory of our Creator. All too often, we stand in awe of everything but God. Wow, that is to miss God at the center. Listen to these. These are some things that are, I think, true for so many of us. Here it is. There's a list of about six of them. The first is, awe is everyone's lifelong pursuit. Awe is everyone's lifelong pursuit. Wow. Here's a second one. God created an awesome world, just like we watched that video, and we even talked about some of the things that we shared that might be unique to us that bring us awe, or reading Psalm 8. But God created an awesome world. Here's the third. God created you and me with an awe capacity. God made us the way we are. He made us to be in awe of things. Things that are created, in awe of Him especially. Here's another one. Where you look for awe will shape the direction of your life. Where you look for awe will shape the direction of your life. Isn't that true? Isn't that so true? If you're kind of hardwired where you want to be successful financially, you're going to spend all of your time and effort and energy to raise as much money as possible to take care of all of that sort of need and hunger to have that drive fulfilled in your life. Whatever it is, whatever that capacity is for you, where you look for awe will shape the direction of your life. Here's another one. Misplaced awe keeps us perennially dissatisfied. Misplaced awe keeps us perennially dissatisfied. If we continue to go after things that aren't really at the core of what awe should be, at the center of who we are, we'll be dissatisfied. Whether it's going after money or fame or the pursuit of whatever it is, if God isn't at the center, we will ultimately be dissatisfied. Here's the last one right here. Awesome stuff never satisfies. And that's just like I was saying. Awesome stuff never satisfies. No matter what we want to have, get, accomplish, whatever, it will never ultimately satisfy us. Only God can do that. Wow. Sometimes awe gets a little bit of a bad rap. I thought about this. The word for awe in the Bible, particularly in the Old Testament, but also in the Old and New, is a unique concept. And it is a varied concept. Throughout the Old Testament, when we hear of the word awe, it's usually attached to the word fear, to have fear when God is present. For Moses at Mount Sinai with the children of Israel as they stood at the base of the mountain, it says that the mountain was covered over with smoke and the voice of God began to speak, and the voice was so powerful, so strong, and God was directing the people to give them a certain limitation to not come closer to the mountain. But in his speaking, it says the people were so terrified of that voice that they hid themselves. They hid themselves. They pleaded, they begged with God to stop speaking. Even Moses said, I am terrified and I tremble before God. Wow, there is a sense of this powerful fear of God. And that's part of the word awe. You know, and the word awe also has to do with wonder and majesty. It does. It has to do, yes, with fear and reverence and all of that, but it also has to do with kind of the majesty of God and the awesomeness of God. Wow. And we can miss that. We can maybe say, well, let's divide that. Let's put a fence right down the middle, and let's say, well, let's put all the bad stuff, the fear and trembling on one side of the fence, and the wonder and all of that on the good side of the fence. But that's not what you can do with the word awe. You can't have a fence down the middle. This is a complex concept and a complex word that includes all of those things. The reverence, the fear, the wonder, the uniqueness of God in that word. It's a powerful word. For the early believers in the early church, as they came together, and you know, these are our spiritual ancestors. I want to remind us of that. These aren't just fables or some people that we may thought maybe they lived some time ago. No, these are our spiritual ancestors that really set a pathway of walking with God and trusting God in their lives. And as they lived together, as they came together as a community of believing people, they were strengthened. And in that strengthening time, it says that they saw the power and awe of God. Listen to this as I read it from Acts chapter 2, verse 25. It says this about those early believers. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, a gathering together, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Then listen to this. Here it is. Don't miss this. Pay attention right here. Here we go. Everyone, all of them, everyone was filled with awe. And many wonders and miracles were done by the apostles. Amazing. Amazing. Awe is associated also with its fruit. What does awe bear out? Well, it says here in this passage that wonders and miracles happened among the people. Good things, wonderful things for people. Wouldn't we all love those kinds of things when God blesses us with wonderful things? The results of the activity of God's hand in and among that group of people and in the communities that they were a part of was God was actually moving in such a powerful way that you could see, you couldn't help but see all that God was doing by reaching people, by leading His purposes. And they were the recipients of the blessings of God. In Acts 9:31, it records it this way. It says that the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It grew in numbers. Living in the fear, phobos is the word that's used in Greek, living in the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. The fruit to the church right there was it was strengthened, it was encouraged, and it grew. And it grew. Wow, those are awesome things. So for you and I, the church, as we're a part of the church, you know, we want to experience those same types of things. And we can when we look to God at the center of our life, at the center of our church, at our focus to live by, to put God in His rightful place. Awe. Fantastic. Fantastic. But awe can go wrong. Awe can go wrong. There is a war for awe. The war for awe is fought on the turf of every human being's heart. Every one of us, without exception, has a war for awe. There are a lot of other things that catch our awe that want to take over. There's a war going on. There is. I read this quote, "The awe capacity was meant to drive us to God in wonder and worship. But sin separates us from Him, and our capacity for awe gets kidnapped by things other than God." Isn't that true? Isn't that true? Our awe can drive us to seek other things. I wish it wasn't true of my life. I really do. I wish it wasn't true of my life that I could say, well, other things never get in the way of my relationship with God. But they do. And I can get quickly sidetracked on something that grabs my attention or like really wants my focus for my life. And I know that when that happens, when I catch myself in that way, I have to rediscover my relationship with Christ. I have to come back to Christ and ask for forgiveness and say, no, God, You need to be central in my life. I have to be set right again with God. You know, all this misconception, this misconstruing of what awe is with God, it all started with Adam and Eve. It was their desire to kind of reset the boundaries of life. It's a war over who will rule and control and guide and direct us. Is it something that we want, our own pursuits, or are we allowing God to give us direction and guidance? Adam and Eve had it all. I read this again from the book Awe from Paul David Tripp. I love how he writes this. Adam and Eve wanted more. The serpent held out to them the one thing they didn't have, shouldn't have, and could never have: God's position. He told them that all they had to do was to step over God's clear boundaries and they would become like God. This dangerous fantasy now lurks in the heart of every sinner. We want God-like recognition, God-like control, God-like power, and God-like centrality. This was the initial moment when awe of self overrode awe of God. That's awe gone wrong, isn't it? Awe of self overrode awe of God. We see it all around us. We even saw it in those early disciples when, before they met the resurrected Christ, they were at the center. They wanted things for themselves. They were that way. But after the resurrected Christ came to them, they recognized that it was Jesus that needed to be in the rightful place at the center of life. We recognize it all around us in people, in ourselves, but in others all around us. We see people's lives shipwrecked because of their desire to go after other things, because of their sort of lust for awe in other ways, whether it's financial, whether it's some kind of greed, whether it's fame or fortune, whatever that is for people. It replaces God at the center. And people give their lives to whatever that awe is that they want. And that's not where it should be. It's not where it should be. And this is why Jesus had to come. You remember that Mark 8:36 says this: what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and yet forfeits his soul? Isn't this exactly why Jesus had to come? Jesus came because there's a war in our hearts. And there is a war for the place of awe, the place that God only should reside for us. There's a war going on in our hearts and lives. And the good news is this. The great good news is this, is that when Jesus came, he came to bring us to a place of repentance. Just like our early spiritual ancestor, bring us to a point where the resurrected Christ, his death on the cross, his atonement, the giving of his life for our sins. That when they accepted that, grabbed onto that, that's the great good news. They were freed from all those other things so they could focus with God, with Christ at the center of their life. Where awe needs to be, our awe of God needs to be central. God, our God, is a redemptive God. He is a redemptive God. Rediscover awe. That's my hope for us this year. Is that we would make it, take it upon ourselves and make it kind of a hallmark of what we're doing this year to rediscover awe. And I would challenge you. I would challenge you. Take this year and make it your focus. For all the other things that could be central in your life, go, you know, I need to rediscover my awe with God. I really want God to be central in my life. I want to deepen my relationship with Him. I want to go deeper with Him. I want to trust Him more. I want my faith to grow. I don't want to slink back. No, I want to move forward. I want to have a future with God every day, every day. Hey, just one little exercise. Something I've been kind of working on just the last week or so, but I thought about this. I thought about, you know, what about a great kind of exercise, something you and I could do, maybe something we want to do over the next few weeks, months, maybe even the entire year. It's pretty easy. It's kind of an awe exercise. So up here on the board, I've got this AWE. Awe. Got it? Not tough. Anyway, but here it is. So in the morning, maybe before you even slip out of bed, maybe you do these three things. I think awe with God, this will really help us. Here's the first one. The first part of awe is an awareness. An awareness that we are aware of God and what's going on. And that maybe we, like we read before, we pay attention. We start looking with some wide open eyes at what's going on around us. We're aware of things around us maybe that we haven't been before. And we pay attention to those, and we thank God for those things, whether it's something in the created order, something we see, an act of love and kindness by someone. But anyway, we become much more aware. That's where awe starts, to be aware. To be aware. Here's the second part, is that it is worthy. Worthy. And what do I mean by that? Well, I mean that everything that we do and think in relationship to awe ought to revolve around God. God is worthy. He's the one that should be in the center. So as we're looking and seeing in things, we want to ascribe that worth to God. That God alone is worthy, not someone else, but even when somebody does something great, God gave them the ability to do that. God is worthy. And here's the last part, and that is exalt. Exalt. And exalt is just that. It is to say thank you to God, to bless God, to praise God, to say, God, you are amazing. So whatever is happening, whatever we're seeing, whatever we're beginning to ascribe to God is worthy, we celebrate it with God. We tell God, that's amazing what you have done, God. You know, that's what it means to be a person of awe. We're aware, we're focused on God is the one that's central and worthy, and also that we exalt, we celebrate with God. You know, that'll lift us. I know it's difficult to be alone sometimes. It's difficult to be separated out. We can't always meet. I get all that. But let's change our focus a little bit. Let's, from our inner heart, our deepest part, let's say, I'm going to be a person of awe this year. And I believe that that will really lift us. It will carry us through some challenging times. And it will also give us an opportunity to begin to share with other people what we're seeing, how we're blessed by our God, and how we celebrate that with Him. Let's be people this year. Why don't we be those kinds of people? People of awe who are committed to God. Why don't you pray with me right now? Heavenly Father, we do pray and thank you for so many things. God, may this year be a year of discovery. Open our eyes spiritually, but to things all around us, that we would have an awareness of your activity and your power that is so beyond us. Help us not to go through life and be missing things, even small things, God, and that we would see you as worthy. We would place our praise onto you, God. You and you alone for what you're doing. Even times we may not even see it or feel it. And then, God, that we would praise you. We would exalt you. We'd lift you up because you and you alone are the person that is in the place of awe in our life. God, would you just be that for us today? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks for being with us. I am so excited about this year. I am really excited about where we're heading this next year. And I know there's challenges all around us, but God is greater than all those challenges. And God will guide us through as a church. God will guide us through as individual people. So let's raise the level a little bit this year. Let's say, let's not get trapped in being dragged down. Let's be people who kind of lift the ceiling off and see the heavens that God's created for us. And let's bask in Him. Let that be the benediction, the challenge, the charge for us today as we launch into this new year. God, you be in the place of awe in our lives, and we will praise you for it. Amen. Amen.